right, turn in your Bibles this morning to the book of 2 Chronicles. 2 Chronicles. It's after 1 Chronicles and it's after Kings. So we're over in the Old Testament today. While you're turning there, I got one last little funny from Dr. Long. He just always got a kick out of the fact that I was a Yankee. And I would say something, and he would say, "Son, Yankees like you, I just wonder how we lost the war." He would just give me the hardest time all the time. But I loved him for it. If you weren't being beat up by that man, he didn't love you. That was just who he was. All right, good morning. 2 Chronicles chapter 7. 2 Chronicles chapter 7. We're going to be starting in verse 11 this morning. But I want to ask you this morning. That the title of my message is, "God, do you hear me? God, do you hear me?" And often I've wondered from time to time, does God hear me? Does he hear my prayers? Have you ever had that? Have you ever wondered that before? Have you ever asked that question? God, where are you? Do you hear me? Are you listening? And it's a good question. It's a good question. And actually, I think when we look here in the book of 2 Chronicles chapter 7, we see an imperfect king by the name of King Solomon. He prayed a prayer asking God to hear his prayers and hear the prayers of his people. And it's something Solomon wanted to ensure during his reign. And I think it's something today that we want to ensure as well, that the Lord hears us. Right? I mean, we just had prayer requests. We lifted up prayer requests, these deepest desires of our heart to the Lord. And we ask that God hears our prayer. And the Bible is very clear that Jesus Christ, by dying on the cross, allowed us to come boldly before the throne of God, and that he will hear our prayers. But as we look here in chapter 7 today of 2 Chronicles, it's an amazing verse. We're going to parse out a small verse, but I'm going to give you the full context. It's an amazing verse, a verse that you can actually memorize and hide it in your heart this morning. And Solomon was charged with building the temple for God. You see, Solomon was the son of King David. And King David, you would have thought, would have built the temple for God. But no, God said, "No, you, King David, will not build the temple for me. It will be your son, Solomon, that will build this temple." So after completing the temple, Solomon actually prayed to God. He had this lengthy prayer here. It's actually in chapter 6 here of 2 Chronicles. And I'm just going to summarize it for you, but he simply says, "God, if your people sin against you, if you bring a famine to the land, or you bring no rain to this land, we ask that you will hear our prayers directed towards you, that you will forgive our sins, and that we will live in the land that you have promised us." That was the prayer of Solomon after he built this temple to God. And it's a pretty powerful prayer. It's really a very cool prayer for a leader to pray on behalf of his people. Amen? I mean, that's a leader that I want to stand behind, a man that's going to be, or a woman that's going to be praying for me like that. But again, this comes from a man, King Solomon, who was not perfect. We know the story of King Solomon, and he did not do all that which God directed him to do. He married many wives, and in essence, worshiped gods that he was not supposed to through that. And this book of 2 Chronicles actually was written to record the history of Israel. If you know your Israelite history, that the Israel was one nation at that time, but then after King Solomon, it split up into a northern kingdom and a southern kingdom, and the kingdoms were taken captive, and the southern kingdom was taken captive by Babylon, and they went for many, many, many years, and then the Lord delivered them back to Israel after a time of captivity. And this book of 2 Chronicles was written to capture that history. And it was to encourage those people who had been in Babylon, they would come back to Israel. It was to encourage them to be faithful and say, listen, God has been faithful to you. He has delivered you back to your promised land. So this morning, as we read through this, you go, Steve, that's Old Testament stuff. That's like thousands of years ago. That's even before Jesus. How does that relate to us today? It certainly relates to us today. Because the same God who was working in the life of King Solomon is the same God, Jack, who works in our lives today. This passage of scripture we're going to look at this morning, although it was meant for the people of Israel, Bella, you can use this today in your life. Because it talks to the character of God. It talks to who our God is. So this morning I'm going to read for you 2 Chronicles chapter 7. And we're going to read through verses 11 through 22. But then I'm going to redirect our focus back up to verses 14 and 15. 2 Chronicles chapter 7 verse 11 says this, "Thus Solomon finished the house of the Lord," that was the temple, "and the king's house. All that Solomon had planned to do in the house of the Lord and in his own house, he successfully accomplished. Then the Lord appeared to Solomon in the night, and he said to him, 'Solomon, I have heard your prayer,'" that was the prayer I just talked about, "'and I have chosen this place for myself as a house of sacrifice.'" Verse 13, "When I shut up the heavens so that there is no rain, or I command the locusts to devour the land, or I send pestilence among my people," listen what he says here in verse 14. He says, "If my people who are called by my name and humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn away from their wicked ways, then I will hear from heaven and will forgive their sin and heal their land." Verse 15, "Now my eyes will be open and my ears attentive to the prayer that is made in this place. For now I have chosen and consecrated this house that my name may be there forever." He's saying, thanks for building this, Solomon. I'm right here. And I will hear the prayers of my people. But he gives some conditions here, and we're going to go back and look at those conditions here in a second. Verse 17, but he has a word for Solomon. He says, "And as for you, if you walk before me as David your father walked, doing according to all that I have commanded you, and keeping my statutes and my rules, then I will establish your royal throne as I covenanted with David your father, saying, 'You shall not lack a man to rule in Israel.'" He said, listen, if you do what you're supposed to do and you follow my commandments, that covenant I made with David that said that there will be a person from his lineage on the throne forever, I'll keep that. And I will establish your royal throne. Verse 19, but if you turn aside and forsake my statutes and my commandments that I've set before you and go and serve other gods and worship them, then I will pluck you up from my land that I have given you and this house that I have consecrated for my name, and I will cast out of my sight, and I will make a proverb and a byword among all peoples. He says, I will use you as an example. And at this house, which was exalted, he's saying, this house, which you're lifting up to me right now, this place of worship that I say I'm going to be at, this house, which was exalted, everyone's going to pass by and be astonished and say, why has the Lord done this to the land and to this house? Then they will say, because they abandoned the Lord, the God of their fathers, who brought them out of the land of Egypt and laid a hold of other gods and worshiped them, and they served them. Therefore, he has brought all this disaster on him. You see, in chapter 7, King Solomon gets an amazing word from God. And the Lord's saying, listen, I will bless you. I will hear your prayers. I will forgive your sins. but you are to be about my works and my commandments. And he says, if you don't, there will be consequences. And y'all, there's those same consequences here for us today, whether we follow his commandments or not. But I want to go back up to chapter 7, verse 14. And I want to look at this beautiful verse of Scripture this morning. He says, if my people who are called by my name humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then I will hear from heaven and I will forgive their sin and I will heal their land. Amen?
Amen.
The answer is yes, Victoria. Lord hears you. And as we look here in chapter 14, he says, if my people who are called by my name, he's talking to his people here. Are you called by his name? We call ourselves Christians. That was a term used at the early church time. Little Christs, that means, little Christ. Not that we're God in any sense, but little Christ. We are Christians. We are followers of this wonderful Savior. We are called by his name. So when you say you're a Christian, you are a follower of the Lord Jesus Christ. He lives inside of us, Rodney. Each and every day, we carry with us. Wherever we go, we follow, we carry the Lord Jesus Christ with us. Whether you're going, Rodney, to go work and you're working on European cars, you're taking Jesus with you. Roy, whether you're going up to Gatlinburg or you're driving around 285, you're taking the Lord Jesus Christ with you. And Jesus said in the book of John, chapter 10, verses 1-16, he says, I am the shepherd and the sheep. My sheep know my voice. Do you know his voice today? If you are a Christian, if you know the Lord Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, and the Holy Spirit of God lives inside of you, you know his voice. Amen? The Holy Spirit of God, you know his voice. It's clear to you, his voice. A lot of people say, well, what does it sound like? You only know when you're a Christian and what that sounds like. It's when you're all alone and you sense that sweet spirit of the Holy Spirit, or if you have sinned or the conviction of the Holy Spirit will come on you and say, hey, don't go that way. Go this way. Remember my word. Verse 14, if my people who are called by my name. Victoria, the Bible says we are adopted sons and daughters of Jesus Christ, of the Father. We are in his kingdoms. We are heirs, we are co-heirs of Jesus Christ, of his kingdom. I love what it says here in Romans chapter 8. Romans chapter 8, verses 14, it says, for all who are led by the Spirit of God. If you're born again child of God today, you are led by the Spirit of God, right? Because he lives inside you. For all who are led by the Spirit of God are sons of God. For you did not receive the spirit of slavery to fall back into fear, but you have received the spirit of adoption as sons, and I'll add by and daughters, by whom we have cried, Abba, Father. So when we look at this passage of Scripture, it says, if my people who are called by my name, he's talking to us who are called by his name and are Christians, you are in his forever. You will never be plucked out of his hand if you are truly his today. Amen?
Amen?
Let's just keep going further in this verse. If my people who are called by my name humble themselves. Ruh-roh. That is one of the hardest things for us to do, isn't it? I mean, really. I have a hard time humbling myself. It's just one of those things of being a human being that we tend to look out for number one, and then we'll look out for number two later, right? It's just, And it's one of those things that I think many of us struggle with as Christians. And I'm here to say we probably will struggle with it for the rest of our lives. Until one day we are like Dr. Long and we're in glory and we will not have this sin oppression on us anymore. We won't have the influence of sin on us anymore. What a glorious day that will be. I mean, I don't even think we know what effect sin has on us right now. We've always known it. Can you imagine one day when there's no sin, what the thoughts of our minds will be? People say, well, how will we worship God forever? I gotta imagine we will worship God forever with a clean heart and a clean mind with no sin. Because everything else, each and every day, we're thinking about what we gotta get done for the day. What do we gotta get done at work? What's going on with my body? What's going on with so-and-so? And we're just continually worried. But one day there will be no sin. And we will be able to truly humble ourselves. But the Lord is asking us to humble ourselves now. And it's tough. And many times we just give lip service to humility. Well, I'm just a humble person. No, you're just saying that. You're being prideful in your humility, you know? Because pride in the things of not of God, but in pride of the things of our being, it's sin. And what he's really talking about here, I believe, is he's talking about humble ourselves before the Lord. He's talking about our relationship with God. He's saying, you know what he's saying? Who's here has seen Finding Nemo? You've seen it? Okay. You've seen the movie. All right. You remember Nemo wants to go to school. And his dad finally lets him go to school. And he's getting to the school bus, and Nemo goes and hangs out with his friends. And then Nemo wants to go out into the deep, right? His buddies want to go out, and they want to go out and look in the deep. Well, his dad chases him out there, and he says, Nemo, get back here. And Nemo's all upset. He goes, what? He says, Nemo, you think you can do things, but you just can't. And remember, Nemo gets upset. He's like, no, I can do things. But Nemo finds out that he can't do those kind of things, right? He finds out that his dad knew best not to go out into that deep. And it's like almost God is telling us sometimes, Miss Susan, you think you can do things, you think you know the answers, but you just don't. And what he's saying is that he's saying, trust me, humble yourself, come under my teaching, Steve, the Lord is telling me. He's acknowledged that I am God and you are not. What God is saying is, acknowledge that I created all of this and you did not. Acknowledge the fact that I saved you and you did not save yourselves. That is what he said. He's saying, humble yourself. Get off your high horse, Steve. Come under my commandments. Listen to my word. Trust me. I am your God. Amen. It's like I want to go out into that deep, just like Nemo, and I'm like, I want to go out there and see it. He's like, Steve, you think you know things, but you don't. I know what's out there, and it's not good for you. Humble yourself. So I go back up to verse 14. If my people who are called by my name humble themselves, we can take that with us just there this week, can't we? By going out of these doors this week and realize we are called by his name. And if we just humble ourselves. But it goes on. He says, and pray and seek my face. Pray and seek my face. And you say, well, does God have a face? What does God's face look like? Well, we get a glimpse of that, right, in the New Testament, because Jesus says, well, Paul says that Jesus is the image of God, right? He is the exact image of God. Or Jesus even says, if you've seen the Father, if you've seen me, you've seen the Father. But when we think about the Father, Son, the Holy Spirit, when we think about the Father is spirit, right? So the Father doesn't physically have a face. So what does it mean then to seek the face of God? He He's saying, seek his presence. Seek him. Seek God's presence. Because in the Old Testament, the Holy Spirit of God was not living inside of believers at this right time, at this point yet. And the presence of God was found in different places. And it was found in the Ark of the Covenant and such. And in different places. It was found in the temple here. God was still everywhere, but he manifested himself in his presence in different places. And he's telling his people here in Israel, he says, seek my face. Seek my presence. And it's like what Jesus is saying here is, if you want to know somebody in your life and you really, really like hanging out with that person, you're going to hang out with them. If you really, really enjoy a person or you really want to get to know somebody, what are you going to do? You're going to seek their presence. You're going to go find them out and you're going to say, let's have lunch together. Let's have dinner together. Let's just hang out and go watch a football game together. Jack, I like you. I want to go watch a Browns-Titans game together. I'm going to seek your presence. And that's what the Lord is saying here. He says, if you really like me, if you're called by my name, humble yourself and seek my presence. Seek my face. And then one of my favorite passages of scriptures then is Numbers chapter 6, verses 22. It's when the Lord spoke to Moses and he said to speak to Aaron to bless them. And he says this, he says, in verse 24, he says, the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord makes his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. Who wants the Lord's face to shine upon them today? Amen?
Amen.
Seek his presence. Seek him. Spend time with him. You are called by his name. Humble yourself. Pray. Seek his presence. And ask the Lord to make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. If my people are called by my name, humble themselves and seek my face and pray. And number four, turn away from their wicked ways. Turn away from their wicked ways. Dr. Kinnebrew said this morning, the word repentance. It's not said in churches many times anymore, because repentance requires an act on our part. Repentance is turning from sin. It's a willful turn from your sinful ways in obedience to the Lord. He wants us to turn from our wicked ways. James 1, we've talked about that many times. We went through the first and second chapter of James and we learned about temptations. And we're saying, hey, if you're tempted by something, is it from God? No, it's not. Where does that temptation come from? Our own evil desires, the Bible says. Our own evil desires, the desires of our heart, cause us to fall into temptation. And what the Bible is telling us here, and what the Lord was saying here is, if you're called by my name and you humble yourselves, and we pray, and we seek his face, and we turn, if we repent, if we turn from our wicked ways, the temptations and the thoughts. I mean, who's been walking along during the day and you're praising the Lord at one point and then a thought pops in your mind and you go, where did that come from? Right? Have you ever had that? You're like, God, I haven't thought about that for years. Why in the world would you let me even think that? Take captive of that. In the name of Jesus Christ, repent of that thought, repent of that sin, and think of maybe just this verse. Memorize this verse today. If my people who are called by my name humble themselves, pray and seek my face, and turn away from their wicked ways. The Holy Spirit of God lives inside of us, Victoria. The Holy Spirit of God lives inside of us and convicts us of our sin each and every day. And if there is no desire to repent, if there is no desire to turn away from our wicked ways, if there is no desire in your heart to say, God, I'm so sorry that I've sinned against you, forgive me, and I want to turn away from this and follow you, then what I'm fixing to say is a harsh thing, but we may not be of God. If you don't have that conviction in your heart, and you don't have the willingness, desire to turn away from your sins, then you may not know Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. The Holy Spirit of God may not live in you. And it's a hard thing to say from a pulpit, especially in a church like this where all of us, I would assume, are saved. Or have been saved for a long time, but I'm just saying, this is real stuff. This is, the Lord is saying, turn from our sins. Repent. Because it is not godly, and it is not good for us. It's like we are just going to this deep end out there, like Finding Nemo, and we want to go out there. And God's saying, you don't know what you're doing, but I do. Turn away from our wicked ways. Listen to the Holy Spirit of God who lives inside of you. Turn from those ways. I love here in 1 John, you say, well, again, wow, Steve, this message is right from the Old Testament. Again, that was Old Testament. Let me read you something from the New Testament here. From 1 John. Chapter 1, verse 6. It says, if we say we have fellowship with Jesus while we walk in darkness, we lie and we do not practice the truth. But if we walk in the light as he is in the light, we have fellowship with one another, and the blood of Jesus, his son, cleanses us from all sin. If we say we have no sin, we say we have no sin. I'm not a sinner. You've heard that before, right? I don't sin. If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. But, listen to this. If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us of our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. If we have said we have not sinned, we make God a liar, and his word is not in us. That sounds very much like what we just read here over in the book of 2 Chronicles. He's saying, listen, if you just humble yourself and you have fellowship with me and you accept me as your Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. And he says, if you confess your sins or repentance, as he said here in 2 Chronicles, he says, I am faithful to forgive you of your sins and cleanse you of all unrighteousness. The same God in 2 Chronicles who wrote that to the state of Israel, the nation of Israel, is saying the same thing to the Apostle John in 1 John. That's how we know that God is one God. He is one God with one message for his people. So as I go back to 2 Chronicles, I just lost my place. Oh, goodness. Oh, no, there it is. So he says, if my people who are called by my name humble themselves, God, you are God and I am not. So it's almost as if getting on your knees, right? Humble yourselves. You get on your knees to him and you say, Lord, I bend the knee to you. You are my God. If my people who are called by name humble themselves and pray and seek my face or seek my presence and turn from their wicked ways, listen to what it says. Here's the promise. Then I will hear from heaven, and I will forgive their sin and heal their land. I will hear from heaven, will forgive their sin and heal their land. And back over in John, he said the same thing. He says, if you confess your sin, Jesus is He will forgive that. And he will cleanse you of all unrighteousness. He is just to do that. Our God is a good God, amen?
Amen.
He is a good God. And this verse of scripture here in 2 Chronicles is just, as I read through it all this week, and I hid it in my heart and I thought about it, I thought this is a word that we could all take home with us this week. If you will hear, he will hear you. He will forgive your sins and he will heal our land. So where are you today? Are you in a right relationship with the Lord? Are you called by his name? Does he know you? Do you know his voice? He is our shepherd. We know his voice. Are we in a right relationship with him today? Are we in a biblical relationship with him today? God, do you hear me? Does God hear us? He does. But he asks that we're called by his name. He asks that we humble ourselves. He asks that we seek his presence. Seek his face. Turn from our wicked ways. It's what he wants from us. As his children, as his adopted children. If you don't know the Lord Jesus Christ here as your Lord and Savior today, he'll hear you. He'll hear your cry for forgiveness. He'll hear your cry and you say, Lord, I am a sinner. I don't know why I do the things I do. I go to bed at night and say, I'm going to not do that again, right? Who said that before? I promise that's the last time I'm going to do that. I've heard alcoholics say that over and over. Lord, they wake, they go, they drink that night, they wake up that next morning with a hangover, and they say, Lord, if you just get me through this morning, I'll what? I'll never have a drink again. Lord, I promise you, this is the last time I ever lust, or this is the last time I ever do this or I do that. Lord, if you just get me through this time, I'll never do it again. But we do it again, don't we? It's sin. It's sin. And we are called to call on the name of the Lord and say, Lord, I am a sinner. I recognize that I am. I recognize that I cheat or I lie or I steal. And Father, with that in mind, I know that I will never be able to spend eternity with you because you're a holy and perfect God. That's what your Bible says. And then the answer is, well, then how do I bridge that gap? How do I spend eternity with a holy and perfect God when I am just wretched? I can't fix myself. I tried over and over to try to fix myself. I can't fix myself. How do I do it? And God says, you don't do it. I sent my son, Jesus Christ, to die on a cross, that if you believe in him, that he died in your place for your sins, then you can spend eternity with me. That is the gospel. But the hardest thing that we have on this planet as Christians is convincing, by relaying to other individuals that they are sinners. Because we don't want to hear that anymore. The word sin is out of the church a lot, and people just don't want to recognize that they sin. It's just, oh, it's just who I am. No, it's sin. It's sin. My people who are called by my name humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways. Then I will hear from heaven and will forgive their sin and heal their land. Y'all, hide that in your heart this week. Memorize that this week. And as you go about your day, just thank God that you are called by his name. And thank God and say, Lord, I'm being a little prideful right now. Right? I haven't put you in first place. Allow me to humble myself before you. And Lord, I'm going to spend some time with you because you're my Lord. I'm going to seek your presence. I want to spend time with you today. And I'm going to do that through prayer. And I'm going to turn from those wicked ways. I'm going to turn from those things that are not of you, that are ungodly. The Lord's going to hear that, and he's going to honor that. Amen. I'm not saying that this is a 1-2-3 formula and bam, it's like that. I'm just saying that this is the Word of God, written to God's people. True then, true today. And as Roy said in his prayer, it will be true forevermore. Amen?
Amen.
I love you today. I thank God for each and every one of you. And I just encourage you this week to seek his presence. Find some special alone time with your God. Humble yourself before him. Confess your sins today to him. And he is just and right to forgive those. Cleanse you of all unrighteousness. Amen.
Amen.
Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father, we thank you today for being our God. Thank you today for hearing us. And God, I thank you personally for allowing me to have this time to share your word with your people. This is a serious moment, Father, in which your word is opened and it's proclaimed. And God, I pray that you just honor what we went through today. But more importantly, Father, I pray that you will work in individuals' hearts right now and this week. And if there is anybody within the sound of my voice, Father, that does not know you as their Lord and Savior, Father, that this be a time in which you convict their heart and show them that they need you. They need you in their life because they cannot do this on their own. But Father, for those who have trusted in you and love you and call your Son Jesus Christ their Lord, Father, I pray today that this would be a renewing in their spirit, that by the power of the Holy Spirit this week in their lives, that this simple verse in 2 Chronicles chapter 7, verse 14 and 15, that it would be something that we can hide in our heart and trust in today. Use it to renew our spirit, to call us back into a peaceful and loving and worshipful state with you. I love you and praise you. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.